mostly he specialized in the bioinformatics part. That's what we thought, and my senior colleague suggested it is better, it will be a right option to keep the person who is currently involved in the information technology and bioinformatics. That's why I requested sir, and he immediately agreed the request, though it is very short notice. Sir, we are very thankful for your kind acceptance, and I request the committee to kindly conduct the session. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, and a very good morning to everybody. Welcome to the third session of the IPS Virtual National Symposium on Advances in Plant Health Management. So, thank you, the organizers, for the opportunity of chairing an important session in this symposium, Information and Communication Technology in Plant Pathology. So, before starting the proceedings, I thought I request my co-chair, Dr. Deyappa, to say his introductory remarks.
Good morning, everybody. So now there are a good number of speakers are there. There are totally three lead speakers and three oral presentations are there. So let us start without wasting the time, since a very short time is there. Sir, I'm requesting chairman to start the session now.
Okay. Anything?
Dr. Selvarajan now.
Yeah.
Dr. R. Selvarajan?
Yeah.
Sir, do you have any input? Sir, you're muted.
Yeah, 1 minute.
So I request Dr. Selvarajan to make his presentation, and he's a good friend of and from the deep learning techniques to what is that, Internet of Things.
It's muted.
And support system.
Now it's okay.
Yeah, okay, it's okay?
Yes, sir.
Oh, okay.
Sir, make it slideshow.
One minute. Yes. Our respected chairman and co-chairman and my dear friends. This is the topic which I suggested to keep our Dr. Nalathambi on ICT, because this is one of the growing field and in plant pathology also a lot of applications are there in ICT, and which is neglected over the time in our IPS. So I thought I requested him finally when we were searching for the people, no one were there. So finally then I accepted. So let me give something on this, since I am handling a project, a DST project on IoT based detection, pest and disease detection in banana. So it's a 1 year old project which I am running, but I just reviewed a literature and which I am going to present with you. So this, I am going to talk on this deep learning techniques for real-time diagnosis of plant diseases and IoT-enabled decision support system. And I may give little bit concentration on the banana. Coming to, see, nowadays we get lot of...
Go to slide mode, full slide mode.
Full slide mode?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah.
We get, lot of WhatsApp queries in the problems and remedies, And these, many pathologists, if any banana means, immediately it comes to me or Thangavelu or Loganathan, because we are specialists on the banana. So we get a lot of WhatsApp images. One picture comes and what is this and what is the remedy? This is the one query regularly people used to ask. Always, we need a specialist to answer and give a decision what to do, whether to remove the plant or not, and all these things we have to depend on the human intelligence to identify a disease and to take the decision whether to go for spray or anything. So we get to numerous number of this WhatsApp images. And as I said, not only the farmers, normally they send, we have got many farmers, banana farmers group, WhatsApp group, more than 10 or 15. And I would say we would have received more than 2000 such pictures, and we have given the remedy. And this is what the things going on as of now. So these are the pictures, you know, it's very tough unless a specialist intervention is there to identify this. A common a banana grower or any other student or any other people cannot be able to do it. So if you get a pictures like this, you can say, oh, this looks like wilt, oh, this is a variety or that variety. So, and we need to few images, not a single image, you cannot be able to tell. But, you know, like in diseases, like viral diseases also, you have to identify and this one. So this, when you get a typical symptoms, one can able to tell exactly what's the disease and what the remedial measures can be taken, you know. So these things are very, very important. And this using a human power we do or we are doing. But the same things, instead of silver agent support to identify a banana diseases, what a machine, whether you are mobile, once you take a picture, can it deliver what is the disease and what decision has to be taken? That's what the machine learning. So whatever we do, it can be done through a machine. So for which we have to train a machine. So machine learning concept allows the machine to learn from examples, like what you feed the data set and also the experience that is a trained model, you know. So that trained model can be used, the experience model, that's the machine learning. It enables the computers or the machines to make data-driven decisions. So whatever the data which we are given as an input, that only will give the decisions will be given that's being explicitly programmed to carrying out the certain tasks. So normally in traditional programming, what we do is we give an input data and we develop a program. So give a input data and we develop a program and you get an output. That is a traditional programming. So 2 into 2 is the input you are giving. Then the program you are making, the multiplication program you are making, the output comes, it's a 4. So in machine learning, it is like, you know, data, you give the data also, you give the output also. Like if I am keeping a data means image data, let us say I am putting a secret local list for diseases and a photograph, 2D photograph I am giving as an input, the output I write as a secret local list spot. So input, I am giving an image, the output I am writing as a secret local list spot. So here the neural network is needed, program, we have to design such a way that the output we should get exactly secret local. When you put a symptoms, when you feed a disease symptom of Sikatoka, the output come has to come as a Sikatoka. So the program the develop, that is a neural network which we develop, that the accuracy has to be keep on increasing till we get a desired output. So the data input and output we feed initially in the machine learning. So that's what we, let us say here in the end user, what I put new input data, that is a, let us say this is a mobile. See, the mobile taking a picture, it goes to the machine learning algorithm and it predicts what is that. Once if it predicts, that same thing can be taken as an input to again train the already machine learning algorithm. Again, it goes as a input. This is called transfer learning, we call. So model input data, again, it goes and again, it will be going to the ML machine learning algorithm and it will give the further improvement. So earlier it is 90% accuracy, it will give 95% accuracy. So this is the machine learning. In machine learning, you can say it is a supervised or unsupervised or reinforcement. In case of supervised, this one predicts the next value. Okay, so the prediction of future case, that is use the rule that predict the output for the future inputs. That is for the learning the labeled training set. Like we will be learning, if I am putting an input of diseases of hundreds of Sikatogalis, but images, so we are labeling and making a training set, and that is a supervised learning. And unsupervised learning, it normally happens, there is no output, it grouping the similar instances, like, you know, color quantization, and in bioinformatics, you know, learning motifs. So in reinforcement learning, we do the labeling, but we again learn from the mistakes. So again, we are improving over this. So reinforcement learning is like, it's a deep learning like. And coming to the machine learning, the supervised learning, it can be classification based and regression based. The classification based, you can know, see, it's a pattern recognition, face recognition, character recognition, speech recognition, medical diagnosis, biometrics. So this all comes under this classification mode. Then another is regression mode, wherein to predict a continuous outcome variable based on the value of one or multiple predictor variables x value. So this is another supervised learning. So in machine learning, the thing is when we give an input, we give a feature extraction, it is manually done. Then the machine does the classification and you get the output. But in case of deep learning, the feature extraction classification, both are done in the neural network. So this is what the deep learning differs from the machine learning. It's an advanced model is the deep learning. And what is exactly deep learning? It's a deep learning is a machine learning technique that teaches computers to do what comes naturally to the humans. So learn by examples. So that's a deep learning is a key technology behind driverless cars, enabling them to recognize stop sign or distinguish a pedestrian from a lamppost. You know, now some Kia or some cars have come. You can, using a EVO, some model, you can stop anywhere. So you can control your car. If someone is stealing, it can be controlled. It can be stopped or it can be intimated. So in deep learning computer model, they perform classification tasks directly from the images or text or sound. Deep learning models can achieve state-of-the-art accuracy, sometimes even exceeds human level performance. In case of deep learning, that we can see the machine learning, the hidden layers, this is what the computer does, the big thing. Here, a lot of, the hidden layers, a lot of filters are added, and it's all a neural network, like it's each extracted features are connected to further filters. So these layers, too many layers if we have, then the precision will be very high. So the term deep usually refers to the number of hidden layers in the neural network. Traditional neural network, only 2 to 3 hidden layers are there. But while deep networks will have as many as 150 hidden layers. So deep learning models trained by using large sets of labeled data, a neural network architecture that learn features directly from the data without the need of the manual feature extraction. That's the only one. Then there are examples, you know, it is being used for automated driving, aerospace, medical research, electronics, and the recent past in agriculture. So what are the most popular type of the deep learning is deep neural network is known as convolutional neural network or CONVNET, we call it. So in CNN, convolves learning features with input data, uses 2D convolutional layers, making this architecture well suited for processing 2D data, that is images. Okay, this automated feature extraction makes the deep learning models highly accurate for computer vision. And the CNNs learns to detect different features of an image using 10 and thousands of hidden layers. That's what, more and more number of hidden layers, it gives you more this one. And there are many such models are exact. It's available open source actually. AlexNet, VGG16, VGG19, ResNet50, MobileNet, ImageNet. There are many the CNN platform are available, which can be taken and we can use that, and that goes as a deep transfer learning. So already existing models, if it is performing, you can use it for our purpose. So okay, what is Internet of Things? I think this is everyone knows that. A network of physical objects called things that are embedded with software, electronics, network, sensor, that allows these objects to collect and exchange data. So now you know that using your mobile, you can operate your, you can put on your AC before going home, you can put on your AC, you can put on your refrigerator or washing machine or anything, you can do it. So your washing machine does not have anything, but you are keeping this internet connectivity there. So you make and you can operate, you can handle, you can put on your switch on. So this, the object which is a dump devices like fan, car, toaster can be made into using this Internet of Things, you can make to work. So coming to the this AI powered banana disease. So in banana, one of this Michael Gomez Silveraj from the CGR Institute, they have developed a wonderful deep transfer learning for detection of banana diseases and pests. And they have targeted around 6 diseases, and including one or two pests actually. So they used a deep convolutional neural network and transfer learning they have applied. So in various fields, and the process, if you look at, first you have to collect the image collection. So this image collections, as many as images which you collect, that's very, very important. Once you collect this image, you have to label it. This labeling can be done, label IMG is a software available which using which you can label the data. So within a symptoms like cicatocal spot on leaf may contain cardinal spot, cicatocal spot, freckle disease. A single leaf may have a different type of, so you can have multiple, a single object, single image, you can have many labeling you can make in a single image, and you can do the data splitting. So once you do it, this is the filters, like you can give the brightness, you can reduce the brightness, you can tilt the photograph, you can crop the photograph, like that you can make augmentation, data augmentation. And once you make that, then you can keep a, the total number of sets can be made into training data set. So you had trained the machine. For that, you can have training data set, maybe 60 to 70% or even 80% images can be used for training data set. Then you can use some 10 to 20% for validation. Then finally, you can use a testing. So whatever you collected, maybe 10,000, 20,000 images, which can used for training, then that is called reinforcement learning. So while we are doing validation, that is a reinforcement learning, then the trained models you get, then you take the testing data set and see how it performs and evolution, whether it is exactly detecting or not, all those things you can do it. So this they did in using deep CNN. And in fact, you know, see in case of Fusarium wilt disease, the symptoms comes not only on the yellowing of leaves, but also in pseudostem wilt disease splitting. But if you see the comb, again, if you cut, you will get the brown discoloration. So a single disease can have multiple symptoms at multiple stages also. It did not be in the early stage, late stage, bunch emergent stage. So in a given any diseases, you can have like, these people have taken a six different models. The one model for entire plant, leaf, pseudostem, fruit bunch, cut fruit, comb. Like six different models they used. So totally, if you look at this, 18 different classes are there. And the five major diseases, and including one comb weevil also they have taken. The total data set, they have 70% they used for training, 20% validation, and 10% for testing they have used. And you know, this particular, they came out with a one app called Tumeni app. Before which I would say that it's a full plant. When you take a picture like this, and you have to label it exactly which has to be focused. So BBTV, this picture is BBTV, they are labeling. So this is a bunch, they are again labeling the bunch. The leaf, they are again labeling exactly the leaf, not the entire picture. So this labeling process is very, very important. And here, the pathologist or the specialist input is very, very important. Here, if we fail anything wrong, you will get entire, the deep learning process will go wrong. So like in Fusarium wilt, you know, the leaf just hangs, it's not even yellow, but whether it's a Fusarium wilt or bacterial wilt, this has to be only the experts can exactly work out. So they used three different architecture, that is faster RCNN inception V2, then ResNet 50, then mobile net. So SSD single shot detector. So single shot detector. So they have used it. And you can see they have trained more than 50 hours in case of SSD mobile net. And the accuracy, they what they got is very high in this single shot detector. So what they got in a different model, accuracy was more in the mobile net version. What is accuracy, sensitivity, specificity? So sensitivity, you know, specificity means if I give a cicatocal spot image as input, it should come as a cicatocal spot. We should not, some other things should not tell us a cicatocal. So we should, there should not be any false positive. So if lesser the false positive, the specificity will be very high. Sensitivity also like that, true positive. So exactly what we want to detect, it should detect. There should not be any false negative. So this has to be reduced. Accuracy, you take total positive, total negative divided by total positive, total negative plus total positive and false positive and false negative. So accuracy value can be whether increasing by changing the models, by changing the filters, you can increase the thing. And another is that in case of onion downy mildew, they have done this group, this Wonsu Kim group. they used actually, you know, image fed automatic crop monitoring. This, they kept a system in the field itself, in the field itself above 10 meter away, and the original images it was taking, the camera takes, this is the system what they have made, and that system contains pan, tilt and zoom lens, everything, and this is at a distance of 10 meter away from the field it's kept, and every half an hour it keeps on recording the images. And using these data sets, they trained and validation, and they did the test sets using a 5-3-2 ratio, and they got around 85 to 90% accuracy in this automated version. This is a field model where this can be done. But whereas when here, what I was telling in Banana, that was a mobile, they have deployed in the Internet of Things, that is, in the mobile, when you capture a picture, it will immediately say this is a Cicatoca or not. And of course, that model is being now kept in a deep learning perspective, that it keeps on improving that one. And coming to the tomato diseases, that here they have used for many diseases of tomato, where they use the meta architecture, that is a reinforcement learning, feature extractor and classifiers are together. And this again, as I said, the data annotation and data augmentation. So a single picture can be made into multiple number of augment. You can augment the single input and you can augment. Then you can use these things. And as I said, the same methodology. Augmentation of data is very, very important. Here, when you collect the data, as I said, different types of symptoms a plant may exhibit. Inside the leaf means upper side of the leaf or lower side of the leaf, like the input. And within the leaf, it may be which disease, where the disease, everything can be made. Is it stem or leaf or fruit, and different size of the plant. So augmentation here, as I said, resizing, cropping, rotating, horizontal flipping, like that we can do it. And they have taken leaf mold, gray mold, canker, and the pest like miner, powdery mildew, and even including the background. The background also should be taken in an image. So that they made, you know, they have taken 1,350 leaf mold, but they are annotated that the box pixels are 11,922. So though the number of input the images are less, they augmented. So this is where the experts has to put the effort to make labeling using these bounding boxes. So once you annotated, then you can use different types of meta architecture. So there are three types of meta architecture used, and again the future extractor, they used many. So ResNet 50, 50 means 50 layers will be there. You know, the number of, more the number of layers and better the accuracy. So here they use the number of layers, you see as much as 101 also they have used it. And they got such a very good, you see the accuracy, it's very, very high. Three different meta architecture they have used, and it's almost more than 88% here, under 79% on 80%. So they are getting better and better this one. But I think all might be knowing about the plant village, which is having around 50,000 images for many diseases. But those pictures are taken in the laboratory, bringing the cut leaf and they take the picture in the laboratory, they developed. But that was not working good because there were no backgrounds. Backgrounds are only some paper or something like that. So that was here you can see. See here you can see all the background. It's not a field background. It is something background, some color pictures are there. In this plant village, this one, you know, it's not so good. It was not so working good. And of course, this Mohit Agarwal group, they reported. And the accuracy varies from 76 to 100% also. But of course, you know, this is where in the field level, if you take a pictures, that differs from this type of thing. So it's better to go for a field level pictures and do a good feature extraction technique. And this is another thing is that the cotton diseases they have done. Again, they have used the CNN model, deep CNN model, using both infected healthy cotton leaf. And they trained the model with 10,000 iterations. And the accuracy was around 98%. So if you do the more number of iterations, you'll end up with a good accuracy. And coming to the rice blast, this is a very interesting. Here, no image and all, nothing. So based on the weather parameters, it can say blast is coming or not. You know, just a visual image detection typically is too late if all blast has come, if it is detected, if you go for a spray, it may not control much. So you have to build in advance, you have to detect. So they're using the weather parameters itself, they are trained. In training phase, the experienced farmer may also check if the rice blast occurs. The farmer sends the results through the smartphone. So again, they plowed back. So they used the, they enriched the data and using the humidity as well as the warm temperature. And they made this, trained the this CNN, and they got the rice blast could be accurately detected at 90% accuracy. And this makes them to go for the spray well in advance. So this is the total, the flow chart given here in the right down corner. So this is a wonderful software, means rice top. It does for rice blast. And rice and maize disease detection also they have done a similar thing. But here, you know, the images are uniformly processed into RGB model using Photoshop. So this also you can make a lot of, before feeding into the machine, you can change a lot of, you can bring to the uniformly using like this also, it can be made. So this is the, like, you know, manually you get to do plant image collection, images, then labeling, classification. So when you go for a real-time images, like your mobile, what you take, the machine does the image pre-processing and augmentation it does on its own. And it gives a labeling. Then it trains. Actually, in the existing model, if it goes, it will train, it will validate, it will test. Based on the result, again, it will take as a input and definitively. So if this is a reinforcement model, like it gives a better output. So the VGGNet is another kind of convolutional neural network, which has been developed by this Oxford University and the Google DeepMind. And this has been used to did it for the tomato diseases also. And here the architecture, you can see here, the image input and this VGGNet, and it develops a lot of pooling layers, you know. And all the pooling layers, again, it has got some more inception module and global pooling, and you get an output. So in this, you know, they got a very good accuracy of 96%, 90%, and very good accuracy, and also specificity, you can see 98%. So if any model, if you want to again improve, you can intervene and improve going with more number of models, or changing the future extracted software can be changed, and we can keep on improving to get a better accuracy and specificity and sensitivity. I think with this, in fact, what we do in our institutes, basically for the state specific technology program of DST, we have taken around an image of 20,000 images for bunchy top and weevils and cicadoga leaf spot and a few more diseases. And all we have made some 20,000 images, and we are doing with collaboration of SSN College located in Chennai. And we have off the way in developing this mobile based detection for banana, and for this is actually the project is for specific for Tamil Nadu. So we are concentrating on the hill banana because this is tagged with GI. So we are looking for detecting, and in fact we are also using drone and other different for surveillances drone. Also we are incorporating the AI in that. With this, I conclude. I think I have now taken more time. Okay, I'm in time. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Selvarajan, for a nice exposition of the deep learning techniques, how it can be employed for disease detection in banana and other crops. So it was actually, it is all based on the image. So mostly, it is a maybe ideal for applying to foliar diseases and other things.
Yeah.
So that's what I feel. And maybe we'll listen to other speakers also. Any questions? I think maybe we can take a couple of questions.
Sir.
Please.
Yes.
Yeah. What about the asymptomatic disease plants?
Exactly. We have to take as many number of healthy samples also for machine learning. Otherwise, if you are not taking healthy, then it will go wrong. So we have to, if you take 10,000 infected samples, you should take 10,000 healthy also, of leaf or everything you have to take, without which the model will not work. Yeah.
Okay. Sir, last question.
Yeah.
So since we discussed about almost foliar diseases, is there any work done on below the ground level diseases which are causing below the ground level soil borne pathogens?
Below ground level root, not diseases. For root and all, I think the same group of this one, they are working for rice root phenomics. For phenomics, for root growth and all, they are working using some infrared or something. I don't know exactly, but they are working. But on diseases, I have not come across any such literature. But it can be done. Root rot and all can be done.
Some work is going on, mostly on the volatiles produced by the pathogens in the soil.
Soil, okay.
Some works are already, some groups are working on that.
Okay.
So that is another way of looking, instead of images alone. Now even plant-based volatiles, based on sensors, they yes. can detect, and some of the diseases can be predicted much in advance, much earlier.
That's what he knows, sir. Is it he knows? He knows.
Yeah, not only he knows, there are even some sensors are applied. Even Google is trying in some line, in that line, some new, they have not really revealed much about it. Some programs are going on. I think we will move to the next presentation. I think let me invite Dr. S. Palanivelan, Professor and Head of Department of Remote Sensing, Directorate of Natural Resources Management, TNAU. On a topic, the drones in mapping and management of plant diseases. So we have, the input data is very important, as Dr. Selvarajan has told. So whether it is based on mobile-based or drone-based or a satellite-based imagery. So this is another way of acquiring the data, the inputs. So drones are now widely used, and they are going to play a major role in agriculture. So let us listen to Dr. Palanivelan.
Palanivelan, whether he's here, I think he's not there.
I don't know.
He may be there in another session, I don't know.
I think somebody can. I don't know.
I think I will just check whether if he's in another session or not. I'll just call him and I think
maybe other person can start it.
Dr. Sandeep Mitra is very much here. Yeah. He's a veteran in this field. And let us listen to him, how he's applying AI and IoTs to plant health management. Dr. Santosh Mitra is a principal scientist in computer application. So let us listen from the horse mouth. So he's affiliated to Central Tuber Crops Research Institute, Trivandrum. Dr. Santosh Mitra, please.
Good morning, Chairman. Sir, am I audible now?
Yeah.
We're audible.
Hello, am I audible now?
Yes.
So thank you. Good morning, respected chairman, co-chairman, and my dear friends. Thank you for the opportunity to give a presentation on this very new topic to a very important domain. And shall I share the screen now? So I will be talking on the topic
can put it in the full
screen mode.
Voice is also some breaking, no? Some problem is there.
Because of
net connection here is a bit unstable. No, I am using my own this one.
Oh. You can put off your video.
That's okay.
That's Santosh. You can put off your video.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. And full view, please.
Yeah. Yes. Okay, so congratulations, Dr. Selvajan, for a nice overview of the different deep learning techniques and its application in disease management. And you have given a very good overview so that my load is reduced. So actually, before going to the actual presentation, I want to give a brief overview of what is the pest and disease scenario and its challenges to a group of experts in this field. Please forgive me if I am going wrong somewhere. And what is understood is that around 30 to 35% of annual crop loss is due to pest and disease. So we should see, we should examine why we should go for the latest technologies to control these pest and disease. Because of that, only I'm giving this slide. Because we are incurring a heavy loss due to the pest and disease issues. And another thing is forewarning systems, whether it is adequate or inadequate, we have to examine. As far as I know, there are many forewarning systems developed and implemented by different institutes, either ICR institutes or universities or other private systems, which are working in isolation. But whether any concerted effort is there at a national level or state level, I am doubtful. And these systems, how it reaches the farmers, how farmers will be able to take benefit out of this, these things are actually to be examined. And is there any solution for these things in AI? It is there. It is there in AI and ICT. There are ways to implement or sort out these issues. And shortage of experts, this is a big issue. Dr. Selvarajan has already told, when we see a symptom in the field regarding the banana leaves, he has shown the disease, some symptom is there. But farmers are confused. What symptom is it? What problem it is? If you are not able to identify or recognize the issue, find out the solution. So whether a shortage of experts there or not, other ICR institutes and universities, the majority of the experts are working with the farmers or the field level agricultural extension workers. But there are sufficient number of experts there in the field who can handle the this large number of farmers who are experiencing the issues. But the expertise is there to deal with all problems, that is another thing. So because of all these issues, what happens is it results in indiscriminate use of chemicals. So people do not know whether fungicides cannot be used to control pests, or otherwise pesticides cannot be used to control disease that farmers may not be knowing. So they will be using indiscriminate chemicals and also in different doses. Indiscriminate doses also they produce. So when we look for making different solutions, we have to find out what is more important. So what is important is like prediction is more important. Prediction and quantification is more important than identification classification. So when we sort out that the solutions or bring out solutions for prediction and quantification, then comes to identification and classification. This is what is generally felt from the field level experience or given in literature also. And based on this one, let us see regarding the forewarning systems or prediction systems which are on there. Dr. Selvarajan's presentation, I was watching in that he was telling about regarding rice blast. Advanced information is very much essential. If the disease comes, there is no remedy to solve that problem. So in this background, there have been a lot of models developed for predicting the diseases. So generally, simulation models are there. There were some setups like simulation models. American Phytopathology Society had a website in which they were discussing, they were giving an overview of PDM and crop loss models for the benefit of the farmers. So APSIM, you know that it is a simulation model framework. It doesn't have any pest or disease prediction system, but it was linked with another population dynamic system called DIAMX. IMAX would predict the Western disease system, and it is also has been working well. And NAVFest is a system of simulation model integration platform, which was under the aegis of North Carolina University, USA. And they are also they're handling the issues with the help of simulation models. Like a Bioma disease, that is another platform which handles the fungal diseases. It is also using a lot of generic fungal plant disease models. And soft computing models are the soft computing methods include the fuzzy logic, AN, and everything is coming under soft computing. But from fuzzy logic models were used as decision support system. This agriculture decision support system is the one which was existing in Punjab, and they were using fuzzy logic system. ANN I am not mentioning here because that is now have given birth to deep learning and some such other AI technologies. The forewarning system is a very important thing, and there we have to give stress even when doing AI technology. So now we live in an age of data. Too data is formed or systemed. After the internet and some that out of the total data generated by human beings over its millions of systems, 90% of those data was generated over the last 5 to 10 years. Especially because of the data generated in the form of video, audio, pictures, everything. And from huge data available with us, we have to find out whether we can get some insights or some solutions to solve our issues or issues of our domain of interest. So then it comes the field of data analytics, which gained importance during this age. And under data analytics, what is done is we examine the data. If the different parameters of data and find out we can size or assumptions to solve some of our real-life issues like that. And data analytics itself is of three types, like descriptive analysis is there, predictive analysis is there, prescriptive analysis is there. Descriptive analysis mentions about we analyze the data with us, and we will be able to tell, so what was the average Western disease occurrence in India over the last 5 years, 10 years, and whether it was happened more in South India or in Southeast Asia, Europe, so the picture of what has happened in the past, as well as what is actually in the present, that is what predictive analysis. This doesn't give any hint for prediction, but after analyze this data, we will be able to tell after the relationship people for predict is the is we will establish with different parameters, and from that we will say that in future what is expected to happen. In the analysis is like with more interest to the pathologist, that is plant pathologist or human pathologist, because when the problem happens, some curative measures we can take. So what will the effect of the image, what is the effect of different actions we take in the future? Based on that, what will happen? That is what is done in prescriptive analysis. So these three terms are very much important for data analytics. And the analysis thing which we be exploring nowadays to give predictions about our diseases. For agriculture, the case of here from agri also, lot of data is generated and pumped into our system. So what is the type of data which is most influencing agriculture? One is weather parameters are the main thing, weather and soil parameters. Leaf wetness data, solar radiation, wind speed and direction, soil moisture. These data are taken and pumped maybe 15 minutes systems which generate data at 15 minutes level are there, 30 minutes interval are there, and all this data are stored in our cloud website. One of these to be take five solution for this. Here we are regarding Western disease. Among this, temperature and humidity is very important. Rainfall is really fair. After there are some standard procedure to analyze this kind of burden, which is for predictive analysis, there are some steps we have to follow. First of all, we have to do data cleaning. The data is of the total data set, there will be some missing values. And there no. Missing values, these we can fill it up with algorithms, screens, and such type of model tendencies. Use that data, we can use the fill the missing values. And if some records are important, we even delete.
What happened?
In the connectivity issue.
Connectivity problem.
Okay, now it's okay. Can you see it? Can you see it now?
No, please upload.
Slide, you have to share it.
Share your slide, sir.
Okay. Sorry for the unstable connection.
No problem.
Yeah, not stable here.
Put it in the slideshow mode.
Do you see now? You mentioned full slide, fully screen mode only.
No. Slideshow.
Yeah.
I will start.
Yes, now it is full slide, man. Go ahead.
Okay. So, can it now, Doctor?
Yes,
should I proceed? Is it okay?
Yeah, proceed.
Carry on.
Okay. Once noisy data is the part of the data which are outliers, we say. The IS identification also, there are algorithms like interquartile range, then find out for over. Algorithms can be used. And data transformation is the step to do. There are algorithms in categorical encoding, scaling up. And based on these things, we will make the data fit for our model. And some data may not be used directly for modeling purpose. And feature selection is in the previous, I have shown a lot of weather data we have collected. For developing a disease case, we may not need all this data. So we will eliminate some of the data. We will remove some features from this. There are some algorithms for that thing. That is filter methods, methods, and recurrent feature selection. Some methods are there. Based on that, we will reduce the number of this columns to minimum level, and so that we can generate good information as well as computing time also will be less. Once this is identified, we will find out the relationship between the parameters. Of course, the regression methods everybody is knowing. And regression methods, some advanced methods, other like ensemble techniques called that. We will put in the data in the bag, and there are some algorithms, like decision trees, random forest, extra gradient boost. Many technologies are there in specifically in AI, that predictive analysis. Based on that, we will predict. And predict means what? We will predict that whether there is chance of occurrence of disease or disease has occurred or not. So once the this event has happened, that is disease has happened, next step is to collect data from the field. collection, there are many technologies are there, but they broadly categorized into this proximity sensing of satellite drone. We collect images of area field. From this, we can identify there are some differences. But after ground truth verification, this is due to disease or some nutrient deficiency or some other issues. And in the subsequent steps, we can go for recommending different control measures or resorting to some control measures. And proximity sensing is actually directly we're collecting the data from the field through our sensor. So the first one you are seeing is eCrop. This is an IoT device developed by CTCRI. This is the first IoT device developed indigenously by ICAR. And this is collecting this weather data and soil data directly from the field and send cloud. And cloud, the model, it may be cost prediction model, disease prediction model. Any model will work on the data and will give our predictions. And in fact, we have used this IoT device only for precision farming. Precision farming in the sense we are using for optimizing the irrigation and nutrient dosages only. Now we have taken up a work in consultation with the help of Dr. Magesh, Dr. Veena and Jeeva also, so that we will collect the weather data from the field and through our AI techniques, we will collect images also from the field directly and altogether we will come out with certain solutions. The predictive analysis part of this particular project has already been over. Now under DST project, we are taking up this in the field level also. And this is an ordinary weather stations, automatic weather stations, which everybody is famous, everybody is knowing. And through mobiles, we can take images from fields and send it to the cloud. These are the through different proximity sensing methods, which are already in existing. So now see that some photographs are there. So I am a layman. I do not know actually these diseases. But after consulting with experts near me, like Dr. Magesh, I came to know that this is EM. And this one is also our experts, soil science expert, this is boron toxicity in cassava. But these two symptoms, I do not know what it is. Even this crop also, not much familiar. Seems to be rice. I don't know whether it is rice or wheat crop. And this symptom, whether it is pest or disease, that also I am not sure. But here only the need requirement of the experts, like Silvarajan told. So the Silvarajan also raised the same issue that since there is no experts, we are not able to identify the disease or problem. So to compensate for the expert, availability of experts only, we are developing AI techniques. So I will explain a small AI technique which Silvarajan also told, this convolutional network, which is coming under deep learning techniques in which more hidden layers are there. That type of networks are called deep neural networks, in which only one is available, like artificial neural network. That is a simple neural network. When there are more features are extractable, when we need more and more hidden layers and more iterations are there. See, this is a input data is fed into that convolutional neural network. So this is the image which is factorized, which is given in the numbers. So convolutions are this small frame, which is maybe around 3x3 or 5x5 frame, that will move along this images like this. Algorithms are developed. So if 3x3 frames are going on, next it will come out with a max pooling layer. Information will be available, but first into say 12x12 framework. So again, after max pooling is there, and again the procedure. Now it has again come to AI in 8 framework, and now 4x4. So this big image, 28:8, now reduced into 4x4 size, but containing all the information. Fed the fully connected normal deep neural network, and it comes out with a identification, right? It will identify that this is CMD. This is what a convolutional neural networks does. But the real situation that having a control network for some disease like something, we need 1 lakh. That many number of data is required. That many number of data. Developing is also a tedious time. It needs space and speed of everything. So what is network summoned a research institute or in collaboration with any agencies. Once such network is available, we will in the background and small set will be fed into it, into this section. And here, source data is huge, which is available while developing the CNN network, and it will be coming out with some parameters up to this stage. That parameters will be our input into more for. So that is transfer learning. That's why now everybody is resorting to transfer learning. That is what the solution operated model. Freeze the parameters. These parameters will be frozen as far as this model is concerned. And after leading it, the parameters from this end onwards will be taken into consideration. We will come out with a big solution. But let us look into some of the cases of doing that transfer learning and CNN networks. Transfer learning strategies on a pre-trained model on a planned data sets and others using general objects. So there are some the models developed with the help of, say, cat and mouse, other plant diseases, and another different images. Such CNN networks are available. There are some CNN networks which are made of alone for plant diseases. But after doing transfer learning in both sets, success was in with the general deaths to the low. Many aspects to be discussed on this particular thing, but this is happened in many of the studies it is reported. And features and flaws trained with there are two combinations of images we train. One is a particular crop and like cassava, banana, sigatoka. That we train. Once we train a thing, it will be having the features of the crop also in that model. And that will be a misleading thing in the later case. Assume that sigatoka is infecting some other crop also. Otherwise, mosaic disease is infecting some crop also. If the parameters of cassava is not there, CMD will not be detected properly. The parameters of banana is not there, sigatoka will not be detected properly. So now we can come out with another algorithm. That is, we will train only the disease parameters alone. So if the mosaic disease parameter is trained of and in a model, then if that mosaic disease is coming in cassava or sweet potato or some brinjal or any crop, we will be able to identify that disease properly. So that is what one is called a COO algorithm and another is called a COD algorithms. And I will be finishing my presentation with this slide. This is how to build an AI solution for crop health management. We have to consider two cases. One is on research front as well as dissemination of the solution to the clients. In the research front, what are the basic requirements? We need a huge cloud computing platform. Because we are dealing with a large size images, maybe hyperspectral images, and a large storage spaces as well as computing capabilities needed. So we need a computing facilities. Image capturing using drones and satellites is very much essential. Large data sets from the field will be collected. Weather and other parameters determining the pest and disease. For that one, IoT sensors are a must. And above all these things, quality manpower. But think about dissemination of this thing to clients. How can we do this distributed clients? That is what I mentioned, that we need a national level or government-sponsored facility which is offered with a cloud computing facility for the data farmers and as well as from the research front. And farmers will be requesting a dissemination through mobile apps, etc. Need-based solution. Farmer will be photo and send it out. And the cloud will be trained, that will be tested with the trained model and come out with the solution. This is what inside what is good. So this brief about the research front and dissemination front to use the solutions. And I think I have overstepped my allotted time. And thank you very much for the opportunities. Now time for discussion.
Thank you, Dr. Mika, for a nice presentation. And you have given an overview. And it's a hands-on experience. So you have developed the crop. And based on that, you know, in that background only, you were developing this topic and how it can be applied for plant health management. So any questions? I think. Anybody has any clarification? I think third speaker is ready.
Sir, Palani Velan has come.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah, Palani Velan, I think. Selvakumar, you can wait.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, Palani Velan has come.
I'm sharing. Yes,
yeah. If there are no more questions, I think we will thank Dr. Mitra. Thank you.
Selvakumar, you can stop sharing, please.
Yes, sir. Okay. I'm searching how to stop it.
Okay. And the green will be there in the top, you see. Just.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
And we will move on to the last lead lecture by Dr. Palani Velan.
Okay. Selvakumar, you could not.
Yes, sir. I switched up.
No. You have to.
That is a screen. Okay. Now we got. Okay.
Yeah. Thank you.
Switch up and yes, left.
Dr. Palani Velan is a
because of your pressure, he left.
Of mood sensing.
Yes.
You'll be talking about the application of drones in disease mapping and management.
So, good morning to all. First of all, I thank the organizers for giving me the opportunity to share our experiences in drone applications. In general and in particular to disease mapping and management. So am I audible?
Yes, very much audible.
Okay. Very much audible.
Slides, okay. So the TNE is a pioneer in establishing the Department of Remote Sensing and GIS among the agriculture universities. And we are having exclusive division for application of remote sensing in different fields. So earlier we were concentrating on soil mapping. Now we have expanded our wings to crop mapping, crop monitoring, yield estimation, then disaster, agriculture disaster impact assessment, and water resource management. Now we have taken up these drone applications. So TNAU has three drones, one in copter type, plane type, and the spraying drone also. So we are mainly concentrating on drone applications in agriculture. So we have three types of drone. One is the fixed wing UAV, the first one, so that flies at a speed of 125 kilometer, and it can cover an area of 40 square kilometer in one day. That means four missions. So it can fly at a height of 1 kilometer, up to 1 kilometer. So depending upon the resolution, what we require, we can use this. So this can be coupled with the different sensors. I will tell you the sensors later. Then the second one is the quadcopter. That is the copter type drone, which can fly at a speed of 6 kilometer to 20 kilometers, and we can it can fly up to a height of 100 meter. So this is mainly used for closer coverage of incidences, mainly pest and disease incidents, stress, everything. Then third one, to improve the applications, we have acquired the spraying drone. So this one is the spraying drone. So this is a in spraying drone, there are various types. We are having the advanced one, that is a hybrid drone, fuel operated, and it has 3 hours endurance with a 16 liter capacity. So With these drones, we have the sensors also, different types of sensors for mapping. That is, one is multispectral sensor. So we have a multispectral sensor with 5 bands in blue, green, red, red edge, and the near infrared, and the daylight camera besides the thermal sensor also. So our main applications, we are standardizing these drone applications in agriculture, mainly in 3 fields. One is mapping and monitoring. So mapping and monitoring, generally for crop mapping, crop condition, crop health monitoring. Then precision agriculture, now we are moving towards precisely mapping the pest and diseases and the nutrient stress. And we are with the collaboration from ITC, that is University of Twente in Netherlands, we are moving into variable spraying drone. Instead of going for variable rate applicator, we are planning to convert the spraying drone into variable spraying drone using the maps generated from the drones, mapping drones. This is also attempted for spraying organics, nutrients, growth regulators, plant protection chemicals.
Slides are moving, sir.
I'm giving it.
Okay.
So we are, so these are different applications we are approaching. So already TNA has formulated a big team of scientists for drone application, standardizing these drone applications with remote sensing, GIS specialists, then pathologists, entomologists, that is plant protection scientists, then soil scientists and crop physiologists to take care of application of different nutrients. So the sensors I was discussing, for any mapping, we should decide about the sensors to be fixed in the drones. There are different types of sensors, mainly 2 types. One is multispectral and the hyperspectral. Then thermal sensor is a different one. So in the multispectral sensor, it is widely used.
Sir, actually your slide is not visible, or sometimes it is shown on the other side. PowerPoint. I'm not sure whether other participants are viewing the slides.
Now it's okay.
We are seeing it.
Now it's okay.
So these multispectral sensors, we use 3 to 6 bands in visible and near infrared spectrum. We generate the vegetation indices based on the and used for stress identification. There are different types of sensors available, different brands. Parrot is the major player in the field of drones. So they share, they have 85% of the share contribution in drones. And MicaSense is the leader in the sensors. So MicaSense Red Edge MX has 5 bands, and Sentira, there are different sensors available. So we have to select a perfect sensor in case of, but in the multispectral sensor, since we have only 3 to 6 bands, we can use mainly the red and near infrared for generating the general stress identification. For precise information on pest or disease or any location-specific incidents or nutrient stress, we have to segregate these pest and disease incidents from nutrient stress. We have to use these hyperspectral sensors. So hyperspectral sensors are multiple narrow band in visible and near infrared, and it has range from 400 to 2500 nanometer. But the we have to consider the cost and the payload, how much this drone can carry. So most of the copter type drones, they have the capacity to carry a payload of 750 grams. But now advanced drones have come to carry up to 1.5 to 3 kg. So that when you go for addition of many bands in the sensor, it increases the weight also. So we should take care of that. So these changes in plant canopy reflectance in specific wavelengths due to pest and disease infestation can be studied using this hyperspectral sensor. So mainly in hyperspectral sensor, we have two types. One is brands are there. That is Field Spec. Field Spec is the product from Spectral Evolution, which has 400 to 2500 band, 500 nanometer with 1026 bands. And now the Headwall company has come up. It is having two types. One is depending upon our requirement, we can split into two sensors. One is 400 to 1000 and another in the range of 1500 to 2500 also. So depending upon the requirement and the budget availability, we can select the sensors. So these are the different companies. These are the spectral range. So for complete evolution, for example, for nitrogen, we can study with the NDVI or in the red and near infrared range. But whereas for potassium, we are getting the exact reflectance and the discrimination in around 2340 nanometer. So like that, we are generating the spectral library for different diseases. So first of all, we have to generate the spectral library and we have to discriminate the bands, which band can clearly identify or discriminate the incidence of disease. For each and every disease, now we are generating the spectral library. From that, we can discriminate 5 to 10 bands. Those 5 to 10 bands, we can customize in our sensor for exclusive disease mapping. If we combine 2 to 3 purpose, then we can combine 7 or 10 bands in the sensor so that we can go for mapping. These are these. So once we have the sensors and the bands, we can formulate different indices, which one is effective against a different stress. So for example, the structure, that is our influence of disease, it really influences the LAI, green biomass, and in that case, NDVI, enhanced vegetation index, normal differential water index. There are so many indices are coming up. So we can also develop our own indices for effective disease identification and mapping. So these are with the different combination based on the availability of sensors or bands, we can identify the effective vegetation index to identify the plant stress. So generally, when we go for this drone applications in agriculture, it has a lot of scope in monitoring, crop monitoring, health assessment. Health assessment means mainly the nutrient, moisture stress, then pest and disease incidents. Then now the agriculture spraying has picked up well. There are many private players also. The government side, many, for example, we are having a collaboration with the MIT, Anna University, Chennai. They are developing their own drones. So like that, around 52 companies are there. Many private players are also there on agriculture spraying. But indiscriminately, they are using without any standardization. That's what TNA is aiming to standardize the agriculture spraying with the drones. Then disaster impact assessment. So you can see the drone image of Gaja cyclone, during which the many of the coconut trees were uprooted or dislodged. So those trees were exactly mapped and identified. The number of trees affected were counted. Then we are using these drones for farmland boundary detection and retrieval of automated land information system. Developing automated land information system we are working. Now we have come out with another methodology that is called 3D geo information. So that any damage to trees, then the rural households during the cyclone and other disasters, we can assess. So once we use these drones and pick up the image, we get a true color image. This is as such what we see with open eye, it will show. Then digital surface model, then chlorophyll map. Chlorophyll map, you can see the difference. This is the study what we have conducted with in cotton with around 200 genotypes. It is a germplasm trial where we have assessed the the different parameters and helped the breeders in selecting these genotypes. Then this comes the NDVA. So wherever the stress is there, that can be detected and correlated to whatever stress happening with the ground truthing also. But when we go for drone applications, there are challenges also. One is the quality software. Of course, now the PIX4D software is available. Then legal aspects. So we have to get the permission from the DGCA. So now DGCA, in principle, for mapping drones, is giving permission to National Agriculture Institutes, agriculture universities, and the principal secretary to the agriculture of any state. So any player can approach the DGCA with the collaboration from agriculture university or ICAR, then the principal secretary of a particular state, we can get the permission for mapping drones. For spraying drones, we should get selective permission. Whenever there are specific needs, we should apprise them and get the permission. Anyhow, at present on pilot basis to take these things, we should get only the local permission from the local administration. We should inform them. And already we have registered with the DGCA portal. Whenever we are having mission, we inform them. Then the initial cost of purchase. At present, the cost, the mapping drones ranges from 5 lakhs to 20 lakhs. Then the spraying drones also in the range of 5 lakhs to 20 or 25 lakhs. So it will come down in due course, depending upon the, in case of spraying drones, depending upon the spray volume or carrying capacity, it varies. If it is 5 liters or 10 liters, it ranges from 3 lakhs to 5 lakhs. Whereas for research purpose, we can take, we can make use of these. Then for higher volume to cover larger area, the battery operated sprayers, it costs around 10 lakhs. When we go for the hybrid drone, which goes with fuel and battery together, so it with a carrying capacity of 16 liter, it costs around 20 to 25 lakhs. But in due course, once it is getting approved and getting used in larger area, the prices will come down. Then interference with the airspace connectivity, especially in case of plantation crops, mostly the pathologist, we try to apply all the plant protection measures. We try all our research mainly in plantation crops. For example, tea, coffee and other plantations where the connectivity is a problem. So we should get the proper GPS signal, because last time when we tried at Valparaiso, we couldn't get proper connectivity of GPS. We can operate it with Bluetooth, but we need the GPS for base map generation. So connectivity is also one of the major issue we should consider. Then weather dependence. It is applicable for normal spraying also. Then defining the parameters for spraying in the absence of specific formulation. So in India, we don't have specific formulation for drone spraying. For example, we are having specific formulation in Japan and other countries, but here we don't have specific formulation. So when we go with the available formulation, we have to standardize the parameters. So this is the fuel-operated hybrid spraying drone. It has the endurance of 3 hours with 3.5 liter fuel, that is petrol, and the maximum takeoff weight is 45 kg. Now, we are in another project, we are trying to develop a model with 100 kg takeoff weight. So in that we can get around 35 to 40 liters tank capacity. That is what we are trying. But now in this, when we used this this specific drone with the 16 liter capacity, we found that the spray volume is not a major limitation. So like our power sprayer, we can bring down the drone. Once the spray fluid is over, then refill immediately. Within 3 minutes, we can take off for next spraying. The flying speed is adjustable. That is 0.5 to 8 meter per second. So depending upon the wind speed or the quantity of spray fluid we have to apply, we can standardize this thing. So at present we are in between 3 meter and 5 meter, 3 meter per second, 4 meter per second, 5 meter per second. Then the maximum height it can fly is up to 20 meter. So normally we fly this spraying drones 1 meter above the crop canopy, or if it is barren, for example, pre-emergence herbicide and other very shallow crops, we fly at a height of 3 meter, where and we can go up to 5 meter also in the field crops. But it can fly with this payload up to 20 meter height. So we can target the plantations also. Already we have demonstrated in coconut in on a pilot basis. And this maximum flight distance is 5 kilometer. That is the range. We can control the flight with from 5 kilometer distance, up to 5 kilometer distance. Its takeoff and landing is vertical. Once it takes off, then we put it in the autopilot mode. The number of propellers 4, spray volume 16 liter, spray type high pressure, that is atomizer. So since earlier we tried with the deflector type nozzle only, now we have come out with the atomizer, so that the spray efficiency, that uniformity in spraying is very good. And we have 4 nozzles. Then maximum. Hello. There are some disturbances.
I think Dr. Santosh Mitra, can you mute your mic, Dr. Santosh Mitra?
So the maximum spray speed, we can put it at 0.75 liter per. I am explaining these things means many of the plant protection scientists may be interested in using these things. So with the available formulations, we should concentrate on these parameters. Once we standardize, then only we can recommend the drone spraying. So this is the atomizer type nozzle. This is deflector type nozzle. So this is the fungicide spraying what we have tried against the blight in rice crop. So we have used the copper hydroxide, that is Cocide 2000, 35 grams for 16 liter of water. So we have used a spray volume of 28 liters per acre. So against the normal recommendation of 100 liters. So the pathologists here, they should test for each and every chemical. Since we are going for 4x from the normal concentration, we are going for 4x. So up to which concentration it doesn't have phytotoxicity. That's what we are going for. Because if you increase the spray fluid, spray volume with the drones, then the operational cost will increase. So to earlier, but in one swing with 5 liters, it can cover 1 acre, this spraying drone. But we have standardized it to, because with 5 liter means the concentration is very high, it will create phytotoxicity. So now we are planning to come out with 4x concentration and with a spray volume of around 30 liters per acre. So with the view of pathologists, it was said it's okay. At 4x, it is not creating phytotoxicity. And we have sprayed in 5 acres in a demonstration, in the demonstration plot in the agriculture research station, Bhavani Sagar. And we are assessing the efficacy is good, they are telling. I couldn't present the exact results, the observations made by the pathologist, which I may share it later. This is for follow-up. So this is the drone spraying in a large scale. So in a time span of 5 to 10 minutes, we can cover 1 acre, and we can take up large scale spraying with the swarm of drones. That is the main thing. Because nowadays, in the rainfed and rice fallow conditions, the situation doesn't favor us to have wide window. The response time is very less. In that case, our drone spraying has the potential to cover larger area in quicker time span. This is another demonstration in a tomato field in the against the tomato leaf blight. So the hexaconazole spraying was taken up with 12 liter for 44 cents, that is 0.44 acre. And these are the preliminary trials we have taken up for standardizing this fungicides. Like that, we are taking up for pesticides, then organics, nutrients, PPFM, like all these chemicals, whatever the recommendation generally available with the university for normal power sprayer or hand operated sprayer, we are standardizing this with the drone spraying. For that, we have formed a team of 16 scientists in the university. And we have demonstrated these capabilities by for spraying these drones in mango as well as coconut. So in one spraying, we have taken up for coconut blight. Even though in coconut, coconut rugose wheat fly is the major devastating pest. Based on the request from the pathologist, we have done the pilot study in coconut, this one. So so to way forward, to make these applications of drones in disease management, definitely the spraying drones, that too with the improvement of incorporation of the incidence maps, variable spraying drones have a lot of potential. But initially, at Indian condition, since the labor scarcity is there, the response time is very less, we can go for this drone spraying as a replacement. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for the nice presentation. It was the know-how of drones, how it can be applied for plant protection services. So that was nicely explained. So any questions from any participants?
Palaniwilan, I have one question.
Yes.
You know, in case of cicadocalis pottendal in exporting countries, like in Ecuador, Latin American countries, they take in a year, they go for 35 to 40 spray using an aeroplane.
Yes.
Small plane.
Yes,
and yes. 100 to 200 acres they used to spray in a stretch, actually. Can this artificial intelligence, can this thing, not drone, but that flight itself can be used for a variable rate application, like you know, where the disease is not there, why should they spray? Where the disease is there, they should spray. Like that things can be integrated.
Yes, sure. But in our Indian condition, the farm holding, size of farm holdings limits the application of this type of big drones or unmanned aerial vehicle and the copters. But these drones, we can use it even for small fields. For example, this drone can be used for a plot of 0.25 acre. Up to size of 0.25 acre, we can use it. That is the advantage we are having. But large-scale contiguous plantation is there, definitely we can go. But a lot of environmental issues they are questioning when we go for this type of big copters and planes, when we use this type of chemicals, that is the...
Sir, I think the question is different. I don't know. Can we, instead of a blanket spray, you know, can we have variable dosages?
Yes.
Depending on the symptoms or whatever, no, pocket...
Yes, sure. That's what we are trying in collaboration with the ITC, that is the University of Twente, Netherlands. We are making a chip and we are transferring. First, we fly the mapping drone. We map the area, identify the disease incidents, then we inject it, we put this chip to spraying drone, and we are converting this spraying drone into variable spraying drone.
Yeah,
that's what we are taking up in this. In another 2 months, we are going to start this experimentation.
So you have to have two times it has to fly. One mapping, and another is
Yes, that's what.
Based on GPS, it will the locations it will identify.
It will generate maps. So the mapping drone will generate maps that will be injected to this one. This spraying drone also is operating on the base map. Okay. So definitely in the specific location. So we have unofficially we have worked out that we can reduce 7 to 15% of chemical or plant protection chemical usage when we go for this variable spraying drone.
Yeah, I think that should be the approach. Otherwise, no.
That's
in the intense scenario. It will be misused as a simple replacement for a manual
labor.
For applying more dosage, higher dosage, and the environmental fallout will be much more than the normal the plant protection operation.
But what's happening in the field is at present many private flyers are there. Yeah. They apply the recommended concentration only, not the recommended dose. Because of that, they simply spray with 5-liter spraying fluid with the recommended concentration. It leads to it becomes sublethal. So what happens? The resurgence in pest and disease happens. So because of that, at present in many places they started using to standardize that one. First case. Second case, to go for variable spraying drone to reduce the usage of plant protection chemical. These are the two approaches we are.
Yeah, is it because of that the some legal restrictions are already there because you have to take a permission?
Legal restriction, it is pertinent to the airspace. That is the DGCA, Director General Civil Aviation. We have the limitation for up to 50 meter height. There is no limitation. There is no restriction.
Only because of that, or I was told that the use of drones for the spray.
No, spraying. Physically. So the second thing is the payload. You should not carry any payload. Okay. That is the thing. So at in the some 6 months back during the locust incidents, they have given permission for spraying drone. So like that incident specific, they will give. We have to get the permission.
Okay, one question, Professor Pajnavaran. Yes. Actually, the drones are using particularly in a hard situation. For example, wherever there is a flood or in the hilly areas, yes, like that. But the technology is very good. But you have mentioned in the challenges, there is no connectivity. Okay, or the weather is totally dependent. At the situation, how can we use these drones in that locations? Particularly assessment of crop losses, the weather, it is totally different. Then how can we use these drones?
Sir, weather means that, for example, during the Gaja cyclone, it was cloudy. Cloudy means no issue. But once we have rainfall, rains there, we cannot fly it. So such type of weather, that is applicable to normal spraying also. So weather sensitive, then the connectivity issues, mainly we have to make this spraying drones to act automatically in autopilot mode. We need the base maps to be loaded, or otherwise we can use it manually. We can spray it, we can operate it manually.
Thank you.
These are the limitations.
Dr. Pranivelan, I am Dr. Santosh Mitra. Sir, congratulations for the nice presentation. I was told now. The issue you are mentioning, is it for this nano and small category, which are less than 2 kilo payload, including camera? Is there a legal restrictions there to fly such for mapping purpose alone if you are using it?
Up to 10 kg, there is no limitations. There is no restrictions.
So if you use for mapping purpose, spraying only limitation will be there.
Spraying it is there. Payload means they put restriction. So if it is a... If it is an university or government authority, they permit.
That means with the recommendation from the principal secretary.
Principal secretary of agriculture.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
I think because of time, the paucity of time, I think we will conclude here. Thank you, Dr. Palanivelan. I have a few more questions. I will get connected with you.
Sure, sir.
And Maybe I think I request our co-chairman to take over and conduct the oral presentation.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Now there are totally three oral presentations are there. I think all three people are present here and they are online. Now I request Dr. Shalokumar. Is there?
Yes, sir.
Yes, he will present the topic digital detection of airborne rust in inocula using smartphones and paper folding microscope in the sugarcane fields. So please, Shalokumar, please, particular time is most important, 6+3 minutes.
Is it visible?
Yeah, visible. Please slide mode.
Yes.
Now okay, your time starts 6+3 minutes.
Okay, sir. No problem. Thank you. Good morning to all. I am here to present the results of a small experiment on detection of airborne iridospores, which are present in the sugarcane field. As we know, sugarcane is a major contributor for white sugar in the world. 80% of the sugar is coming from sugarcane, and this crop is grown in more than 110 countries. And India ranks second in both area and production. From India, there are more than 50 diseases reported, and our major emphasis is on red rust resistance. So in our country, other than the major diseases, minor diseases are also there, but under changing climate condition, they are emerging there. So for managing these minor diseases, there is no other way other than depending on the chemicals. So but for management of minor diseases using the chemical is not an economical always. But in some conditions, we have to spray the field with the chemicals for containing the diseases. So rust. Rust is one of the very minor diseases in 1960s. After 1960s, there is no rust in sugarcane. And for last 40 to 50 years, there is no problem of rust. But in coming years, in these recent past years, many released varieties are getting this rust problem in the field, and they are not accepted by the farmers. So there is a need to manage the disease in the early stage if it is severe under the epiphytotic condition. So in sugarcane, there are three types of rust. One is brown, one is orange, and another one is the tawny rust, which is a minor imperfection. In India, we are facing that, in particular in southern peninsular zone, we are facing brown rust, which is called by Pacsinia melanocephala, and orange rust called by Pacsinia crinum. Here, rust, it can be easily detected in the field by rubbing the leaves with these fingers. We will see this rust powder on the fingers. It can be easily detected, and the microscopic view of these spores is like this. But the idea is, the rust is like a wildfire. It will spread immediately in the field if the susceptible variety is there and the favorable environment is there. So to detect the presence of rust in the field before the appearance of the symptoms, if we can detect the iridospores which are present in the air using some other thing other than these are all the common spore samplers which used. Of course, I don't think we are using this type of spore sampler for detecting the airborne pathogens from the field. So here, but our idea was to capture the iridospores which are present in the field using these simple glass slides, which is coated with the vaseline. And the slides were kept in this thermocol, which is having an 8-sided one, which is just a waste of our bottle container. And we kept it in the field, and we observed once in 15 days. And really, we are happy that these slides can capture these spores which were present in the field throughout the season. In some months, we couldn't detect, and in few months, the spores were in plenty. So we could capture the spores using this simple technique of using the glass slides which were used earlier. But the problem is we have to see under this simple or compound microscope in laboratory. So here, based on this spore appearance and the symptoms in the field, we can see that the rust is a problem during November to February. It was in the field. And another one here you can see, it is from July to February. And we can say that based on this spore trapping and the symptoms in the field, we could classify the occurrence of this rust in two periods of this year. One is during January to February, and remaining will be from October to March. Because when the crop is there in the field throughout the year, so the inoculum is present in the crop. So always we use that compound microscope to see the spores. And here, this is the one which I could come across from the net. This is a fold scope, which can replace this compound microscope. It is nothing but a simple paper. It is made from a paper, or we can say that it is a very smaller one, handy, and it can view these spores very easy. So this is the one we can say that these are the types of the spores which can be used to be seen by this, using this fold scope. These are the various pictures taken by the University of Columbia. And here, it is very clearly said that colored spores can be easily seen. So what we did is, instead of this compound microscope, whatever the slides we took it from the field, we kept it in this fold scope, and this can be easily seen under microscope. Under this fold scope. And there is a provision in this fold scope that it can be attached with us, our mobile phone, so we can easily capture the images from the field itself. So here this idea is to use this fold scope during the field survey, and with our mobile phone we can take the pictures. If they are colored in nature, they can be seen for the experience. So with this idea, we can say that this fold scope can be an alternative for the people who are visiting the field frequently, and if they are dealing with a crop which is caused by a pathogen which is producing a colored spore, they can be easily detected by placing these simple Vaseline coated glass slides in the field. Frequently, if you are observing, there is a correlation that the symptom appearance and the capture of the spores on the slides. And mainly, this technique can be used for other crops where the rust is a problem, because rust is a colored one, and that can be easily taken. So with this one, I want to thank everybody for this knowledge. Thank you.
So thank you very much, Selu Kumar, for your in-time presentation. Any questions from the audience?
Hello.
Yes.
Your smartphone means we have to use app, or directly we can take a photo?
So directly it can be attached with our smartphone, sir. With the camera, this is the one, sir. I don't know whether it is visible or not.
Okay.
Okay, it can be attached, sir.
Okay.
Simply.
Thank you.
Hello, Selakma sir. Hello.
Yes, madam.
This paper fold microscope, where from we have to get it?
Madam, it is easily available in Amazon, madam. 550 rupees only.
Okay.
Yes.
Most of the companies.
Can use, how long we can use?
No, it is a permanent one, until otherwise you damage it.
Okay. Purposefully. Okay. Okay, thank you.
Any questions from the audience? Okay. So if there is no question, please exit from the screen. Yes. Now I request another speaker, that is Berliner.
Yes, sir.
Yes, scientist nematology from Nilgiris. You will present the topic, mapping of a nematode in Nilgiris. Using GSI, GIS technique.
Dr. Devakar, is the time taking this too much time is taking? Time should be restricted. No?
Hello?
Yes, yes. I'm telling about the time.
Dr. Devapai, you have to stick on the time.
Yes, sir. We are in time. No problem.
Okay. No, the presentation time.
Yes. Presentation time.
Yeah. See,
it is already... Sir, from 11:30, the poster session has to be started.
Okay.
So now it's 11:45 and another two lectures are still to be presented.
Yeah.
So anyhow, I have rescheduled it, the posters by 12. So try to complete it by 12.
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Hey, yes, sir. Am I audible, sir?
Yeah, audible, please.
Slides are visible, sir.
Yes, visible. Go
ahead. Yes, sir. So good morning to everybody. So today I am going to present my topic on mapping of nematodes in Nilgiris using GIS technique. The actual aborigines of the Nilgiris subsist mainly on the milk, honey, and meat. But what happens in 15th century, another group of people came from Karnataka area along with the several little millets, mushrooms, and several varieties of beans. So they are the first people to introduce actual agriculture into the Nilgiri district. But after the British colonization, what happens? They introduced the tea, coffee, wheat, and potato. For so long time, for about 1.5 centuries, the potato dominated the vegetable area. But due to the presence of potato cyst nematodes, the late blight, and the introduction of other vegetables, which is highly remunerative to the farmers, the area has come down. So the present scenario, what we have seen is, so instead of a potato, the carrot, cabbage, garlic, and other things dominate the landscape. So what we thought that if the scenario of cropping has changed, why not the nematode scenario has also changed? So we started a random survey into the whole district. What we found was root knot nematode was found to be more prominent in different places. And that itself, not the Haplah, that is the Melodogyne incognita species, which earlier believed to be present only in high temperature areas. Even in the wheat cropping sequence, inside our farm area, it is a Pratelanca species which dominate, but in the farmer's field where they are following vegetable with the wheat crop system, Tylenkorhynchus. Like that, several other vegetables have a Paratylenkus species, but the Helicotylenkus and Ziphanema species found dominant mainly in the undisturbed area. So keeping this in mind, so we thought that why not map the nematode distribution in the current time? So for this purpose, there is a two strong reason why we want to go for this GIS mapping. So far, the available nematode mapping is only the occurrence map that is done by the AICRP of nematodes. And for Nilgiri district, as it is the horticulture-based districts, so already we have a domestic quarantine pest like the PCN nematode. So why not we map its distribution? So we started as a case study. So we took our IRI farm area where the ecosystem is unique and the last 50 years we are growing wheat crop. Mainly. So it consists of about 43.5 acres and the pH is always acidic. Organic carbon is above 0.5. So from this whole area, we took around 95 to 96 samples. From every point, we took the coordinates and we also take the soil parameters like NPK, that EC, pH, and OC, and also soil textural classifications. In nematodes, we quantified per 100 cc of soil, how much is the nematode and how much is the plant parasitic, bacterial feeding, fungal feeding, and omnivore predator groups. So all these parameters were fed into the GIS data. So using a basic Krigging principle, the point data was extrapolated into a distribution map. So the map shows that the total population of a nematode in summer and winter, you can see that it is concentrated towards the northwestern part. Western part, where there is an undisturbed area, actually we have. And in winter area, though the population is very less for a total nematode population, but the distribution relative abundance of the plant parasitic nematodes is more. That means the summer higher population is there, but winter the population is less. But the distribution of plant parasitic nematode, that is in the percentage ratio, is more in winter. So if we subdivided the plant parasitic nematode, we come across 16 genus of plant parasitic nematodes. If we calculate the prominence value among the 96 samples, we come across the Helicotylenchus species and the Meldegoni species, which is highly prominent in our area. So for these two nematode alone, we separately prepared the GIS mapping, where we found that especially for Helicotylenchus species at certain pockets. The certain pockets correspond mainly to the undisturbed system, that is where we are having our garden lands and other grasslands and our guest house gardens. But in terms of Meldegoni species, it concentrated, especially the right side map, if you see, it concentrated at certain points of the winter. That corresponds highly to the weed species, especially the Bidden spilosa and Galinsoga parviflora are the two weed species which act as the alternate host of root knot nematode. But in summer, you can see the more or less equal distribution of Meldegoni. But I have already mentioned that Meldegoni incognita is most dominant when compared to Meldegoni hapla, as it is a southern root knot or a high temperature loving nematode. So in summer, it's reflected. Its population is reflected. So in other bacterial feeding nematode and other things, you can see the bacterial feeding and the fungal feeding nematodes found high in rainy period. But actually, we could not prepare the map for the rainy season, but we found that their distribution is more in this rainy period. So based on the different feeding groups, what we did that using a Shannon diversity index for the nematode trophic group diversity, we calculated the diversity and I tried to map them in the same GIS mapping. When the data was fed, we found that when compared to the continuous cultivable area, we are finding that undisturbed area where it is barren for the last 5 years are having a high diversity. Even monocropping of only wheat is going on in those places, the diversity is less, but the places where wheat crop followed by mustard and potato, the diversity is more. Many might think that mustard is an antagonistic crop to the nematodes, but what happens, what we observed at the time of end of the crop season, we found so many of weed species which act as alternate host. So though there is an allelopathic effect or antagonistic effect on the nematodes particularly enter inside the weed species and survive there. So that's one of the main reasons. So here I can conclude that this kind of mapping will help us to have a proper management aspect. As nematodes are having a negative binomial distribution, that is a patchy distribution, many will be having a problem of up to what extent of area we should have a management aspect. So by extrapolating such kind of point data into a equal distribution map, so we can know up to what extent of area we can put the management aspect. So my future plan is I have to extrapolate the same kind of data to the whole of the Nilagiri district. So I thank you all my team members, which includes from Soil Science Institute at Ooty and also from NBSS LUP and Potato Research Institute, Dr. Priyank and Asis Kumar, who particularly helped in GS mapping preparation. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Berliner.
Yes.
So one or two questions from the audience. Any question from the audience?
Sir.
Yes.
Yes.
What is the basis for selecting the species mapping?
Sir, I have informed in my slide itself. So among the plant parasitic nematodes of 16 group, we have a community structure analysis formula separately. Based on that, we could identify which nematode is prominent in that particular area. It is a formula based on density and frequency. So by a combination of density and frequency, we get the prominence value. So we got the Helicotylenchus and Meldegoni species is prominent in our farm area. So that is the reason, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Berlin.
Thank you, sir.
Now, please, I am requesting third speaker, John Sirani.
Hi.
Are you there?
Yes. Am I audible?
Yeah, you are audible. Please share your PPT.
Sir, slides are visible, sir.
Yes, visible. Put it in the slideshow.
Nice.
Now your time starts. Light show, please.
Good morning, all. I am here to give presentation on role of ICT in decision making by the farmers for adaptation of integrated disease management. Before going to that, what is ICTs? ICTs means information technology tools, means it is any device, tool or application which can be used to exchange or collection of data through interaction or transmission. In recent years, ICTs have been extremely beneficial for the farmers in marketing, precision farming and improved profits. Through these ICTs, farmers have been empowered to exchange their opinions, experiences and ideas and allowed them to use the new scientific technologies which are related to crop protection and crop production management aspects. And the objective of this study is to know the factors which influence the farmers to take decision and the effect of ICT and decision making for integrated disease management practice. For this, we prepared, questionnaire was prepared and we surveyed three villages, namely Challahalli, Somehalli and Haniyuru of Yelahanka Taluk, and we contacted 458 farmers. From the data, it is revealed that many of the farmers are under the age group of 41 to 50 and they completed their 41.92% farmers have completed their high school and 35.8% farmers have completed their graduation. And for them, when we see the occupation of the farmers, 66.15% farmers are having farming as a main occupation and some are having subsidiary occupations like real estate. And many 41% of farmers are having more than 1 acre land. For the diagnosis of the field problems, 25% farmers are contacting local dealers than other sources. For the management of the problem through different governmental organizations, many of the 46.94% farmers are contacting Raita Samparka Kendras than other government organizations. And when we observed the awareness of IDM in farmers, 68.99% farmers are quite understands about the integrated disease management practices. Even though they understand aware about the IDM practices, many of the farmers are under using the chemical pesticides. Only 10.69% farmers are very well understands about the usage of biocontrol agents. And even though they are aware about the chemical pesticides and the IDM level, but they do not understand what is EPL level and proper pesticide storage also. For a single problem, for a single crop problem, half of the farmers are using more than 2 to 3 pesticides, and which are doses recommended by the main, they're following the doses mainly recommended by the direction of local pesticide shopkeepers than other sources. And the time of application, the pesticides they are applying only after the appearance of the problem. Even though they are using more rely on the chemical pesticides, only 18.34% farmers are aware about the safety measures which are following while spraying the chemicals. And they are taking the decision of chemical, half of the farmers are agrees that they are taking the chemical spraying only after the appearance of the problem or any disease or pest. And they are strongly disagrees, half of the farmers strongly disagrees that the awareness about the ill effects of the pesticides. But they strongly agrees that the pesticides can cause health problems. When we look into this, farmers, 91% of farmers are using smartphones, but they are not only but most of the farmers, like 72% farmers, are not aware about the apps which are related to crop production or crop production techniques, and only 5 to 12% farmers are using the crop protection related mobile apps which are released through different state agricultural universities. And we observe the awareness of mass media. 44.32% farmers are watching crop management programs coming in radio and TV programs than with other sources. From the data received from the farmers, it is concluded that majority of the farmers are mainly using chemical pesticides only after the observation of the problem, because some diseases and pests, they appear and the symptoms will appear only in severe stages. In that time, if we spray the chemicals, it is not usable. There is a need to create awareness of ICT-based, web-based forecast models and IBM practices. Even though they are using, majority of the farmers using smartphones, they are not aware about the apps and tools and helpline numbers. Hence, there is a need to create awareness of ICT tools for better diagnosis of the plant disease, which can lead sustainable management. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Jansrani, for your nice presentation. Now, any questions from the audience? Any questions from the audience? If there is no questions, thank you very much, Jansrani, for your presentation.
Thank you very much, sir.
Now I request our chairman, Santosh Ipan, is there?
I am very much here.
Sir, please.
Over, our presentations are over?
Yeah, presentations are over, sir.
Okay, thank you everybody. This discussion now will not be complete without telling about some of the recent developments, especially the technological giants like Google has ventured into agriculture, and their parent company Alphabet has come out with a new project called Mineral, and wherein already they have developed some robotic structures which can sense on a real-time basis anything, not only the symptoms, the temperature, and on the spot remedy it is implementing. So if it requires a spray, if it requires some other input, so on a square meter basis it can handle the issue. We are all recommending based on per hectare and other things. So that is the technology development, and they are calling it as Internet of Agriculture, not IoT, IOA. So that is the new system. And so a lot of computational agriculture is happening. Now we have heard about computational biology. Now it is computational agriculture. So a lot of data, big data at a time, on a real time, it is collected and analyzed, and predictions and remedies are offered. So this is the system, and a lot of developments are happening, and the plant pathologist also should not be lagging behind in going ahead. It is not simple based, image based system alone, and already there is a wonderful software by the Plantix company. It's a German company which is helping in many of our, they are into Indian market. IDCRISAT is collaborating with them, and already many crops already they have taken up, and a lot of solutions on a real-time basis with the mobile-based, and any farmer in local languages they are bringing out. So kindly look into such wonderful opportunities. I think I once again thank all the organizers for the opportunity of, it's a pleasure, discussing about new things, and which always I love to do. Thank you so much, and wonderful presentations all around. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. We will join.